he was 500% engaged with me at all times. He was the dad that was on the floor with you, carving the pumpkins. When we played dress up, he had on the clothes as well. Everything I wanted to do, he fully immersed himself in it with me.
So he got tested in 1998, and we left the hospital, and it was kind of a strange feeling. We both looked at each other and both kind of said, we thought so. He never wanted me to tell her that he was positive for Huntington's, which for me was hard. It was a very, very hard thing to carry in my heart and in my mind. It was like probably the only secret I ever had from her.
I could tell there was stress in their marriage, probably my senior year of high school. So this would have been in 2000. My mom had been diagnosed at the beginning of 2000 with breast cancer. And I just remember feeling like my father wasn't responding to that diagnosis how I would expect a husband to respond. And I later found out that my father was engaged in an extramarital affair.
All this time, mind you, I'm following my scripted thing. I will not tell her. He made me promise I will hold that till my deathbed. And during the separation and divorce, he went ahead one time and told me, this is the real reason why mommy left me. She doesn't want to take care of me because I'm positive for Huntington's.
And I approached her very upset that evening. And my mom had to share something with me. She said, why do you think we bought the house that we live in now? We had just purchased this home when I was 16 years of age. So it would have been right after his positive HD results came back to them. The home had already been designed or starting to be configured for a patient with HD. That same day he told me he was positive for Huntington's disease, he also asked me to sign over all of my mutual funds for college. He told me that he had no money, which was not true at all. And he made me feel financially responsible for his ability to continue to live. And he's the absolute love of my life. So I gave it to him. I didn't hesitate. But I now know that that was just the start, probably the tip of the iceberg of the, you know, the decline with Huntington's disease, making those very, very irrational decisions with money. So that would happen in 2001. There was an incident where he got so angry at me one time. He told me I wasn't allowed at his residence anymore. And he actually called the police to have me removed. They said, your father no longer wants you in his home. And he's requested that you leave permanently. And that was in 2001 as well. And I was about 19 years old. So when he requested that, I never actually physically saw him again until 2016. During that time, he would make phone calls to me. And I remember one time he called me and I put it on speakerphone just so that my mom and stepdad could hear where he was at, you know, emotionally. And he ranted for 3 hours straight. And during that 3 hour time period, never once did I say a word. So he was definitely declining emotionally and psychologically at that point. So I contacted home health services in the area of Colorado that he was living in. And I explained to him, you know, the diagnosis and what he had. And I said, I need you to do a home health visit. I just don't think he's taking care of himself the way that he is. And he won't accept help from me. So I remember like the Colorado Sheriff's Department going out and seeing him, and he was irate. And the sheriff called me back and said, you know, we can't just take someone away for being angry or irritable. And I just felt so defeated, because I thought, this man has no idea what Huntington's disease is, and he has no idea what's starting to happen.
We didn't know that he eventually lost his home in Colorado and had relocated to Florida somewhere, I don't know, maybe 2011, 2012.
I received the phone call Christmas Eve in 2015. And it was from a rehab facility. And they said, "You have your dad. He was only supposed to be here for a couple days, couple weeks. We've had him for over 90 days. When he was getting settled into long-term care and mom and I went to clean out his apartment, it was shocking to me. Like, there was a coffee pot in the microwave that was metal. There were money orders. He was getting wrapped up in internet scams.
It was, you know, it was shock for a while there after we got back in touch with him. I was making timelines, trying to put things together to figure out, you know, what was he doing? And then when I started tracing the money orders, oh, dear Lord, you know, it was sad. It was really sad.
I remember when I actually first was reunited with him in 2016, he had begun to be in diapers and he was very ashamed of that. He was very proud. He didn't want anyone to know. And I remember him being in the little fetal position in his bed, terrified. And I was like, "Dad, there's nothing to be embarrassed about." And I said, "I've got to change your clothes. It's just what we do every day. I do it. You got to do it too." And he was like, I can't. And slowly I was able to coax him with my words and with my cousin's help. And we were able to get his pants off and we were able to change him. And in the middle of me changing him, he says something that I'll carry with me for the rest of my life. He looked at me and he said, "You deserve so much more in life than what I've given you." And I just remember I didn't even hesitate. And I said, "Are you kidding me?" I said, "I already have the best in life. I have you." And he let us change him. We have the most beautiful conversations and the most beautiful moments. Because of Huntington's disease, we know that our time here is limited. Him living with Huntington's disease and me living at risk, we know that each day is a gift and that you live it to the fullest, and you live it to the fullest with gratitude. So I think those times when I am there visiting him, even the simplest of things, we don't take for granted. And everything we've ever wanted to say to each other before we leave this earth, my dad and I have had the opportunity and taken that opportunity to say to each other. So if anything ever happens, he knows exactly how much he means to me, and I know exactly how much I mean to him.
The hardest thing about HD was probably spending so many years thinking of it in a negative sense. Whereas after we became his caregivers in 2016, we began to connect with an HDSA support group and go to national conventions and see other people living with HD. And that some of them had lives with HD, which was not the way it had always been presented to me. It was presented that it was like this doom and gloom.
I remember the first conference I went to in Chicago. I felt so empowered by going to an HDSA conference because everybody there was in the same boat. And there was nothing to be ashamed of. There was nothing to hide. Every story you told, somebody had one just like it. And it was like you had your tribe and your people amongst you. And I just remember going and thinking, I'm not going to be afraid of this anymore. When you get over that stigma of even just saying the diagnosis, that's healing and coping in itself, because you've decided not to let yourself be identified as a diagnosis, and you've now started to move forward being a person with Huntington's disease. I don't see my dad as an HD patient. He will still look at me and say to me, I don't have what you think I have. Oh, and yeah. I look at him and I just say, well, it doesn't matter to me either way. And he'll say, well, it's okay. I don't have what you think I have. So don't worry, you won't get it.
Yeah. He's still trying to protect her that she might be at risk for.
Right.
You know, so it's still kind of back to that denial of put your head in the ground and it's not going to be there. Let's not acknowledge it.
The old house is still standing, though the paint is cracked and dry. And there's that old oak tree that I used to play on. Down the lane I walk with my sweet man.
I wish her father could see her on a daily basis and see her shining at her job and know that she's a risk taker just like him. She's just unbelievable.
The advice I would give to anyone living with HD, I would just like to remind them how much you are loved and adored and cherished, because none of us would be here or be fighting so hard for this if we didn't think the absolute world of all of you. And I would just want them to carry that with them forever. And no matter what declines you experience, to always keep that inside of you. Obviously, anyone going through Huntington's disease, we know there's difficulty and it is not easy. And even though there are moments of such hardship and horror, there's also these moments of amazing, incredible, extraordinary things that happen just because we're living in the moment. So I think when you're an HD family, you don't just live an acceptable life, you live in it, an exceptional one. You indulge in every moment.